respected dignitaries on the dais and my dear friends here. I am very much thankful to the authorities of both institutions, Bharatiya Vidya Bhavan and ISKCON, and particularly to Dr. S. Ranganath for having given me this opportunity to share my thoughts on consciousness in Upanishads. It is a matter of consciousness, being consciously present after the lunch, you know, post-lunch session, usually as Professor Hegde was telling, I am the next person to victimize you. Let me begin. Upanishads are reckoned as invaluable source books of sublime wisdom. They constitute the final import of the Vedas. While investigating various aspects of human life and the universe around, they run into the enigma of the momentariness of our empirical knowledge. Life on earth indeed is so brief and fleeting. Dissatisfied by the insignificance of the fragmented nature of our empirical knowledge, they get to scrutinize various dimensions of reality. They embark upon this analysis with an unmatched thoroughness and a very comprehensive perspective. They question the very authenticity of the world as it appears. As they start developing distinctive meditation techniques, they learn to shed the trivial and start aiming for what is worthwhile. They portray the relative triviality of our earthly endorsements. They comprehend higher truths and more fundamental levels of reality in a comprehensive perspective. Upanishads explore and expose the fallacies of our material confirmations in the light of what they reveal. They disclose the limitations of our so-called objective assessments in the absence of a thorough subjective awareness. Upanishads develop holistic doctrines and offer concrete guidelines for an earnest spiritual seeker to understand deeper dimensions of human consciousness. They enable us to realize the true potentialities of our inner consciousness through guided meditation and insightful reflection. The human mind. Upanishads exert hard to expose the imperfections of the human mind. Human mind is an inadequate instrument. Reality in its totality cannot be comprehended unless the subjective dimensions of the human mind are properly integrated by means of intuitive contemplation. Mind is a tricky tool capable of deceiving us if we are not watchful and resolute. It tends to limit our consciousness. We remain comfortable with our fleeting pursuits of ordinary life. We forget our genuine roots and our advanced aspirations. Keno Upanishad declares, Paranchi Khani Vyatrinat Swayambhu. Human mind, the Upanishad declares, the Lord prepared it like that. The self-existent Lord, while designing the senses, has made them to look outwards. Mind is set as an intermediary between the knower and the known. It makes us keep groping outwards only, away from ourselves, the perceiving subject. This is a purposeful divine design. Call it by whatever name, Maya, Leela, mischief or illusion. It is an undeniable actuality which we cannot deny. We are happily unaware of our own real self and its probable potentialities. We are unaware of our genuine spiritual dimensions. Mind can either help us or prevent us to fathom the depths of consciousness within. Manayeva manushyanam karanam bandha mokshayoho bandhaya vishayasangi muktiyai nirvishayam manaha. Mind indeed is the prime cause for bondage as well as release. Mind that is addicted to sense objects entails bondage, whereas the mind free from passion brings about release. Confronting questions like, what is the nature of the world? What is the basis of reality? What is the relation between the world and the individual, etc., Upanishads come up with life-transforming answers. They emphasize the need to rise above the plane of material awareness to the plane of pure consciousness in order to cultivate totality of vision. Mind-body relation. The mind-body relation or consciousness-matter relation is an undying problem of science and philosophy. The debates between the realist and the idealist are still on in search of a thoroughgoing theory of explanation. An idealist cannot explain the pragmatic world, while the materialist lands in self-deception and self-negation. The materialist scientists are groping in search of a satisfying unified field theory. The seers of the Upanishads, however, propose to ponder over the potentiality of consciousness as the primal source of life in order to tie up the gap between the subjective and the objective perspectives of reality. Mind is an independent seat of psychological functions according to the materialist philosophers and psychologists. Upanishads do not subscribe to the autonomy of human mind. Mind is merely an instrument. It is an organ through which the consciousness operates. Aitareya Upanishad declares that all mental faculties are different manifestations of consciousness. Samjnanam, Ajnanam, Vijnanam, Prajnanam, Medha, Drishtihi, Dhritihi, Matihi, Manisha, Jutihi, Smritihi, Sankalpaha, Kratuhu, Asuhu, Kamaha, Vashaha iti sarvani yetani prajnanasyaiva namadheyani bhavanti. Cognition, awareness, intellect, wisdom, memory, insight, steadfastness, thought, reflection, impulse, remembrance, resolve, purpose, life, desire, control. All these are the operative names of consciousness. Mind is an antahkarana, a subtle internal organ. It consists of four components: manas, buddhi, chitta, and ahankara. Manas is the coordinating factor which governs the five organs of perception and five organs of action. Buddhi is the faculty of discrimination. Chitta is animate awareness, while ahankara is self-identity or personal ego. Ken Upanishad terms the foundational consciousness as pratibodha viditam, that which is known in every cognition. Consciousness is manifest in and through every act of cognition. Every mental modification reveals the light of consciousness. Consciousness is co-inherent and co-existent in every function of each of the faculties of the mind. Knowing anything is possible only through consciousness. In a way, ontology and epistemology converge here in consciousness. Knowing is being, and being is knowing. Ontology, however, is more fundamental. How to be is more important a question than how to know. Who am I is more important than how is it. Adhikara, the role of ethics. Moral integrity is a fundamental requisite in spiritual pursuits. Cultivation of noble qualities, being egoless, austere, truthful, tolerant, and loving, is an indispensable prerequisite for a spiritual seeker. This obligatory qualification is termed adhikara in Vedanta. One has to foster unselfishness and universal love for life and living beings. Turning to the Atman within, not seeking happiness anywhere outside, and reveling in the glory of divinity enables one to recognize the same divinity everywhere. Kathopanishad proclaims that the indwelling self is revealed only to those who are morally upright and mentally tranquil. It declares, Navirato duscharita nashanto nasamahitaha nashanta manaso vapi prajnanena yenam apnuyat. The self cannot be known through the power of consciousness by one who does not withdraw from unrighteous ways, who does not control his senses, who does not meditate, and who is not tranquil within. Only those who are physically, mentally, morally strong can tread this difficult path of spiritual enlightenment. Earnestness and determination to evolve is absolutely essential. A firm resolve is an imperative to achieve spiritual advancement. Only a sincere seeker who steadily marches forward, contemplating upon the eternal truth step by step, guided by an enlightened guru, is competent to fathom the depth of pure consciousness. Kathopanishad declares, Kshurasya dhara nihita duratyaya durgam pataha tat kavayo vadanti. Wise men say that the path of spirituality is challenging to tread. It is like walking on the cutting edge of a sword that is very sharp. Desire to lead a holistic life in the light of the unity of existence is very rare to acquire. Human mind is habitually fragmented and divided. Totality of vision calls for fullness of wisdom. Intuitive meditational exercises help in getting the mind integrated with the inner self to acquire fullness of vision. Consciousness pervades throughout and links the individual with the whole. The self within the heart of every individual is actually the source and substratum of the entire universe. Each individual carries within himself or herself the root of reality. Intuitively, getting connected with this vision is called yoga. It is a technique. It is a skill. Tapas, meditation, concentration, prayer, etc. are all different practices that get the mind disciplined for spiritual advancement. In due course, discordant nodes of our partial knowledge and experience get harmonized by means of these practices. We succeed in acquiring an integral vision in the light of the self-illuminating consciousness within. Meditation brings about the required mental ability, which in turn ensures self-realization. No amount of learning and scholarship can bring about self-realization. Upanishads bifurcate secular learning from spiritual knowledge that is helpful for liberation and realization. Subjective awareness is totally different from objective understanding. It is an intuitive and integral awareness that does not function on the basis of subject-object duality. It is a sort of basking in the light of pure consciousness. It is unifying awareness which guarantees the insight of all learning and knowledge. Prashnopanishads patently says that one who knows Akshara knows everything else. The knower of Akshara is omniscient and omnipresent. Tadaksharam vedayate yastu soumya sa sarvajnaha sarvameva avivesha iti. Shaunaka asks Angiras in the Mundaka Upanishad, Kasminnu bhagavo vijnate sarvamidam vijnatam bhavati iti. Bhagavan, what is it by knowing which all else can be known? Those who know Brahman, replies Angiras, say that there are two kinds of knowledge, the higher and the lower. Dvevidye Veditavye Itihasmayad Brahmavido Vadanti Parachaiva Aparacha Tatra Apara Rigvedo Yajurveda Samavedo Atharvaveda Shiksha Kalpo Vyakaranam Niruktam Chando Jyotishamiti. The lower is the knowledge of the Vedas, the Rig, the Sama, the Yajur, and the Atharvan, and also the phonetics, ritual practices, grammar, etymology, meters, astronomy. All our so-called different disciplines of Vidya are knowledge. They are all lower knowledge. Athapara, by category, this is different. Yaya atha daksharam adhigamyate. The higher is the knowledge of that by which one attains akshara, the changeless reality. What the Upanishads aim at this is the foundational and integral knowledge which is inclusive and all-encompassing. Attainment of akshara is a state of self-awareness wherein consciousness gets self-integrated so as to bring together all awareness in perfect harmony. Consciousness, it is inclusive awareness. Fragmented knowledge is no knowledge. Knowledge that enables totality of vision is real knowledge. It is unifying knowledge. This is the light of pure consciousness. Truth, joy, and purity abide in consciousness. It is at the basis of the world, an unfathomable source of light and energy that is absolutely wholesome and infinitely inclusive. Just as space is so vast, containing suns, galaxies, planets, atmosphere, clouds, smoke, etc., and still remains unaffected by them, consciousness remains pure, unaffected by the changes in the dynamic world. It is unharmed by the taints of any evil. Consciousness permeates our body, life, mind, and intelligence, enveloping the entire physical universe as well at the same time. Brahman encompasses all worlds at all levels of creation. It is so great that the vast physical universe, which is beyond all human imagination, is only an infinitesimal part of the power of consciousness. The Taittiriya Upanishad explains that everything in the universe, like space, celestial, and human beings, air, fire, water, earth, plants, animals, their biological and psychological equipment, etc., all function through the fivefold layers of Brahman: the material, corporeal, mental, intellectual, and divine. These layers are embedded into the structure of the universe. Consciousness is omnipresent in its cosmic structure, stretching across the entire panorama of universal existence, from material world to the unbounded awareness. Mundaka Upanishad asserts that the imperishable akshara is one and it is universal. The immensity of this vast existence speaks of its greatness. Yas sarvajna sarvavit yasyaisha mahima bhuvi. Mundaka Upanishad refers to the Brahman as jyotirmayaha. It is pure consciousness, the light of knowledge. It is also called solid consciousness, prajnana ghana. Brihadaranyaka Upanishad refers to Brahman as the light of lights, jyotisham jyotihi. It is also called satyasya satyam. Brahman is described as our source of life here, as well as the safest guarantor of our well-being hereafter. According to the Mundaka Upanishad, the imperishable reality akshara is like blazing fire. Everything in the universe has sparked off from that original blazing fire. Yatha sudiptat pavakat vispulingaha sahasrashah prabhavante sarupaha tatha aksharate vividhaha saumya bhavaha prajayante tatra chaiva apiyanti. The same Upanishad says that the effulgent self is the whole of reality, and it is to be realized within the lotus of the heart by the seekers through continence, steadfastness, truth, and meditation. It constitutes a distinctive vision and removes all impurities of the seers of its realization. Satyena labhyastapasa hyesha atma samyajnanena brahmacharyena nityam anta sharire jyotirmaya shubhraha yam pashyanti yatayaha kshina doshaha. According to Chandogya Upanishad, it is the form of pure light. Consciousness can will. His will is truth. He is all-pervading. Brahman always remains pure. He causes everything in the world. He remains untainted. And he is joyful. He is the indwelling spirit in everybody and in everything. I'm not going to the details of the quotations here. They are in the notes. Consciousness unifies the universe. Integral unity of reality is not opposed to multiplicity of creation. The transcendence of consciousness is neither aloofness nor exclusion. Consciousness combines in itself immanence and transcendence. 5 more minutes. I skipped 2 pages. The word Brahman is derived from the root brh, which means to excel or to grow. Brahman is that which excels everything in terms of magnitude, refinement, value, and significance. Excellence of Brahman is a derivative of its fullness. It is completeness. Completeness is joyfulness. Nothing that is incomplete can become worthy of our pursuit and investigation. This is the teaching of Chandogya Upanishad. Yo vai bhuma tat sukham, nalpe sukham asti, bhumaiva sukham, bhumatveva vijignyasitavya iti. Fullness is joyfulness. There is no joy in the finite and the partial. Infinitude alone is real. And that is real bliss. The complete and the whole alone is worthy of investigation. What is Bhuma is the most delightful. Nothing comes anywhere near the joy of the self-realization. Brahman is called Purusha or Purna because it is full, it is total. Satyam, Jyotihi, Jnanam, Bhagavan, Paramatman, Akshara, Isha, Tajjalam, Tat, Vanam, etc. or similar other names standing for Brahman, denoting different dimensions. Brahman cannot really be called this or that. It cannot be described either as large or small. It is beyond such dualities. It is beyond any sort of measurement. Description or attribution of any appellation is just to indicate its inclusiveness. There is nothing that is not pervaded by the self, either big or small, that can remain without or to the exclusion of consciousness. Consciousness is present to the fullest degree within the largest entities and the minutest particles in existence. What is omnipresent and omnipotent remains self-supported as well. Chandogya Upanishad raises a question. On what Bhuman is established? And it answers, Sve Mahimni Pratishthitaha. It is established on its own greatness. An initial awareness of the vastness of the world coupled with a desire to attain the eternal and the universal prompts an earnest seeker to rise above the ordinary. He takes to meditation under the guidance of a guru As meditation progresses, empirical mind rises above its fragmented private pursuits of life. It gets attuned to pure consciousness to acquire superior mental faculties. It wins over the conventional mind to realize what is eternal. Truth is eternal. What is eternal is truth. Brahman, pure consciousness. Mind, illuminated by the brilliant blaze of pure consciousness, is rendered sharper and illuminated. It is enabled to focus on the absolute reality. Mind that dwells on reality merges in pure consciousness. Mind preoccupied with Brahman becomes Brahman. Brahmaveda Brahmaiva Bhavati. Getting established in pure consciousness or embracing it, being encompassed by it, is the joy of joys. This is final and permanent fulfillment. This is living through the delightful radiance of the consciousness within. Pure consciousness is Brahman. It is enduring and eternal. Getting established in pure consciousness or embracing it, being encompassed by it, is the joy of joys. This is final and permanent fulfillment. This is living through the delightful radiance of consciousness within. Pure consciousness is Brahman. It is enduring, eternal, and supremely satisfying. Thank you.